you'd like to write us, our zip code is 44065. I'm Pastor Ernie Sanders. And the title of the message this morning is Of Faith and Politics, Of Faith and Politics. And you're listening to us this morning on Liberty Works Radio Network. That's the Eagle, 104.3 FM.
No, it's not the Eagle anymore.
And he says he's not the Eagle anymore.
They're not on the Eagle anymore.
Anyhow, in all of my life, I've never heard so many feeble-minded statements made by feeble-minded people as I'm hearing today. Boy, people are, one of the biggest ones you're hearing all the time in the media, that people are born sodomites or lesbians. Folks, behaviors are learned. No one is born a sodomite. No one is born a car thief. No one is born a pedophile. These are behaviors that you learn. No one is born a pastor. No one is born a nurse. These, again, are behaviors that you learn. And so to say that you were born that way is absolute lunacy. It's total foolishness. You've heard this one. How many times have you heard this one from? Guess who? It takes a village to raise a child. Well, have anybody in here ever heard of a village child? I've never heard of a village child, but I have heard of a village idiot. Okay. And those are the people that make these statements. People of faith and morals belong in a basket of deplorables that are unredeemable. We've heard that one lately, haven't we? Well, here's a good one. Remember this one? Let's pass Obamacare so that we can find out what's in it. Well, that took a lot of smarts. I mean, can you imagine that? Okay. Why don't we vote for Hillary to find out what she'll do? Okay. I mean, this is an amazing thing that we're living in such a time. This is what we call political correctness. The Bible calls feeble-mindedness. Feeble-mindedness, okay? And it calls it simple-mindedness. Then, this one here. There is no God, there is no Creator. Now, that's one of the dumbest ones, the dumbest things I've ever heard. You see, listen, I got to tell you this. If there is no God, and if there is no Creator, there is no us. And if we're not here, who am I preaching to? Okay? And so, and if I'm not here, who are you listening to? Right? Now, if we go to Psalms 14, verse 1, we read this. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Now, so when you hear someone say that, say, you know, you've been written about. Your name is in Scripture. And just take them to Psalm 14 and say, see, that's you right there. Okay. And then if we go to John, in the Gospel of John, in chapter 1, which is a very familiar passage to all of you folks, there are verses 1 through 5. In the beginning was the Word. That's Logos. And the Logos was with God, and the Word was God. Now, anyhow, that word was God. That means essence. That's the same word that we use for the word essence. Essence in the Greek. In other words, the essence of this hand is this hand. Okay. The essence of Big Jim is Big Jim. Okay. The word there where it says with, where it was with. That means face to face, face to face. In other words, in the beginning, God, the Word, Logo, was face to face with God. So you had the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost standing face to face. Okay. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shineth in darkness, and darkness comprehended it not. Boy, I'm going to tell you, the darkness sure isn't comprehending much today, are they? Amen. They don't see the handwriting on the wall, do they? And then I want to take you over to Job. In the book of Job, in chapter 38, this is an amazing, amazing chapter of Scripture. Here in this chapter, you're going to see, as we start off here, that the Lord God rebukes Elihu, for mouth and words. In fact, six chapters, this Elihu mouth, six chapters, and the Lord rebukes him for mouthing off without any knowledge. And of course, the Lord goes on and he wins that argument, but Elihu was a young man, and he came and he was rebuking Bildad, Zophar, Eliphaz, and they all three needed to be rebuked. And he rebuked Job, but Job didn't need to be rebuked. And he thought that he should be much, that they should be much wiser, because he said to them, "I'm really amazed at you, man. I'm a young man. You men are, you've been around for a long time, and I had thought that you guys would be a lot wiser than you were, but you seem to know very little." Well, the Lord comes along and says, "Hey, wait a minute here. Let's read it, starting in verse 1. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge?" He's talking about Elihu. "Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee an answer thou me. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare it if thou hast understanding. Who hath laid the measures thereof, if thou knowest? Or who has stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God," meaning the angels, "shouted for joy. Or who shut up the sea with doors when it brake forth as if it had issued out of the womb?" He's talking about God keeps the seas and the oceans within their realms. You know, there's a lot of water underground, and that water could come up and you know, could flood the entire earth, but the Lord keeps it all where it belongs. "And I made the cloud the garment thereof, and thick darkness a swaddling band for it, and break it up from my decreed place, and set bars and doors, and said, Hitherto shalt thou come, but no farther, and here shall thy proud waves be stayed. As thou commanded the morning since the days, and caused the day spring to know its place, that it make thee hold of the ends of the earth, that the wicked may be shaken out of it." You know, did you ever think about that? A lot of times as you'll go by, and you'll go by these places, especially golf courses or whatever, or some homes, and they have sprinklers systems, and they have them on a timer, and they come on at a certain time. And but just imagine God doing that on the scale of the entire universe. The entire universe, things out there. I mean, the earth is just a little speck out there in the universe. But just imagine the majesty of God, the way he has done that. And, you know, he's done that with us. Every little electrical impulse that goes through our nervous system keeps our hearts beating the things. God has done that with us. Everything has been programmed by the ultimate intelligence. "As thou commanded the morning since the days, and caused the day spring to know its place, that it might take hold of the ends of the earth, that the wicked might be shaken out of it. It is turned as clay to the seal, and they stand as a garment. And from the wicked their light is withholden, and the high arm shall be broken. Hast thou entered into the springs of the sea, or hast thou walked in the search of the depth? Have the gates of death been opened unto thee? Hast thou seen the doors of the shadow of death? Hast thou perceived the breadth of the earth? Declare it, if thou knowest it all." So the Lord is asking Job, "Job, you guys, how smart are you guys? I'm asking you, Job, can you tell me these things?" See, old Job was saying, "Now, wait a minute now, you know, Lord, I think you're being a little bit too hard on me. I think you're being too hard on me. I haven't done these things that I've been accused of here." They accused Job of the lust of the flesh and all kinds of things. And Job said, "I haven't done that, and you know it." And the Lord is saying, "Well, before you get uppity, Job, remember who you're talking to. Remember who you're talking to. You're talking to your maker." And as far as this Elihu and all of these others, they think they know so much. Answer me these questions. Do any of you know any of these questions that he's answering them? And he says, Where is the way where light dwelleth? And as for darkness, where is the place thereof? Did you ever think about that? Light dwelleth in a straight line, and at a certain speed. And guess where darkness dwells? Darkness always dwells in the absence of light. Where there's no light, you've got darkness, right? Thou shouldest take it to the bond thereof, and thou shouldest know the paths to the house thereof. Knowest it thou, because thou wast born, or because the number of thy days is great? Hast thou entered into the treasures of the snow, or hast thou seen the treasures of the hail, which I reserved against the time of trouble, against the day of battle and war? By the way, is the light parted and scattereth the east, wild, or the east wind upon the earth? Who hath divided the watercourse for the overflowing of waters, or a way of the lightning of thunder, to cause it to rain on the earth, whereas no man is, on the wilderness wherein there is no man, to satisfy the desolate and waste the ground, and to cause the bud of the tender herb to spring forth? See, God has programmed all of this stuff. I mean, it's just so far, far, but, you know, men's technology is so minute compared to God's. It is just absolutely, we haven't even started to begin to scratch the surface of God's technology. To satisfy the desolate and waste ground, to cause the bud of the tender herb to spring forth, hath the rain a father, or who hath begotten the drops of dew? Of whose womb came the ice, and the hoary frost of heaven, who hath gendered it? The waters are hid as with a stone, and the face of the depth is frozen. Canst thou bind the sweet influence of Pleiades, or loose the bands of Orion? Canst thou bring forth Maseroth in his season? Or canst thou guide Arcturus with his sons? Knowest thou the ordinance of heaven? Canst thou set the dominion thereof of the earth? Canst thou lift up the voice to the clouds, and the abundance of water may cover thee? Canst thou send lightnings, that they may go and stay unto thee, and say unto thee, here we are? Who hath put wisdom in the inward parts, or who hath given understanding to the heart? You know, God has placed the information. If you want to stymie someone who believes in evolution, just ask them, tell me how the information got into our DNA. How did the information get into our DNA? That is far, 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 far more complicated than any computer program we have today. We don't have anything that even comes close to that. It's an amazing thing. It didn't happen by accident, folks. I got news for you. I did a family tree. Every one of my relatives were men, women, and children. Not one puppy, not one snail, and nothing in my family line ever crawled out of a primordial pool of slime. Can you all say the same? And you need to boldly profess that, boldly out there. You have to be, and I don't want to be mean or nasty on this, but you got to be a blooming idiot to believe in evolution. Who can number the clouds in wisdom, or who can stay the bottles of heaven, when the dust groweth into hardness and the clouds cleave fast together? Wilt thou hunt for prey for the lion, or fill the appetite of the young lions? And when thy couch in their dens, and abide and covered to lie in waste? Remember, in those days when you hunted lions, they didn't have high-powered rifles, right? They were hunting lions with bows and spears. Who provideth for the raven his food, and when he hath young ones, crying to God for wonder of lack of meat? Well, God gives them a little bit of the answer to the question, there is no God. God just answered that argument, didn't he? And he said, now you answer these questions. And then, when they tell you that Jesus is non-judgmental, And Jesus is very tolerant where it comes. This is the message being preached by all your liberation theology people. To justify their sin, they'll tell you that, in fact, you know, they say that Jesus was a sodomite, okay? That he was non-judgmental. But what does the Word of God say? Well, if we turn over to Revelation 19, I think we'll answer that question. Revelation 19, starting with verse 11. And here you're going to see that the Lord himself is going to cast the Antichrist and the false prophet alive into the lake of fire. While we, the saints, fight the armies of the devil. Now, folks, that's being judgmental. You see? That's really being judgmental. You know what else that means? That means you being very intolerant. That's about as intolerant as you can be of sin. And where it comes to tolerance of sin, there was no more intolerant man that ever walked the face of the earth than the Lord Jesus himself.
Exactly.
And in Revelation 19, verse 12, we read, "And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written which no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed upon him upon white horses, clothed with fine linen, white and clean." That's us. "And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness, the wrath of Almighty God. And he had on his vesture, and on his thigh names written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun. And he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and of the flesh of men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. And the beast was taken, with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. Those were both cast alive in a lake of fire, burning with brimstone. And the remnant were slain with a sword of him set upon the horse, which sword shall proceed out of the mouth. And all the fowls were filled with their flesh." Well, that sure don't sound to me like someone who was non-judgmental, right?
Amen.
And so, you've heard another one. How often have you heard that? These people say, and I've seen them time and time, that a political leader must separate his religion, his religious beliefs, from his faith and his politics, or from his politics. I remember hearing Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter was being interviewed, and he said, "Well, I personally am against abortion. I know it's wrong, and I know the Bible calls it murder, but I have to represent my constituents, those that elected me, and they are in favor of it." Whatever. Now, here's a guy that calls himself a born-again Christian. Remember Acts 5:29? We must obey God rather than very, very sinful people, Jimmy Carter. When I heard that right then and there, that told me that man is an apostate, and he's an apostate all day long. And it's just an amazing thing. But you have many of them out there, the same thing. This guy Cain, who professes to be a strong Catholic, he's an antichrist, he's a heathen, he's an unbeliever. And you have the apostates like Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton. These guys are, well, the Bible speaks of them right from the pit of hell. They are ministers of Satan. Jesse Jackson, Al Sharpton, They are ministers of Satan. And see, we have to speak out.
Amen.
And you say, well, how do you know that? Two ways, right? God's word, the Bible, makes it very clear, identifies them very clearly, right? Those are the people that embrace the sin that God condemns. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, it's very clearly, verses 4 and 11 through 15, identifies these people. They're the apostates. And we, all of us, have an obligation to warn the people. The Bible says in Ezekiel 3 and Ezekiel 33 that we warn both the righteous and the wicked. That we warn them to be in compliance with the Word of God. And Scripture says if we warn them and they continue, then their blood is on them. But knowing what we know, and if you remain silent when you should speak out, when these people are making professing this blasphemy, or telling you how they feel, you need to rebuke them. Because your silence, the Bible says, condemns you. Abraham Lincoln understood that. He said, for men to remain silent when they should speak out makes cowards of men and destroys a nation. And how true that is. How very true that is. Well, and he says, we have to learn to separate our politics. Let's take a look at what Daniel said about that, because in Daniel chapter 6, here is a perfect example of how one's faith and politics are inseparable. You'll find the very same with every godly prophet, priest, and preacher in Scripture. And the Lord himself was the greatest example of this, as we start in verse 1 of Daniel chapter 6. Now it pleased Darius to set up over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give accounts to them. Now, princes are always legislators, folks. When you hear princes, it's always legislators here in the Scripture. That the princes might have accounts to them, and the king should have no damage. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm. See, Daniel was considered to be a very, very wise man. In fact, over in Ezekiel chapter 28, you see the Lord himself chiding the prince of Tarsus, Ethbaal the Third, saying, well, Why, you're as wise as Daniel, okay? In other words, when Ethbaal the Third had made the statement that he was God, that he was a God. He said, look at me, look what I've done, I'm a God. So God chided him. He said, yeah, you must be wiser than Daniel. Look at you, all that you have built up, all of these things, all of the wealth, and especially through your slave trade, why, you're a God. But then he goes on to say, no, you're not. You're no God. In fact, I want you to tell the men that I send to kill you, I'm going to send some men to kill you. So when they come to kill you, you tell them that you're a God and see if they believe you. But they won't. And they didn't. And Ethbaal found out that gods don't die. And that's how he found out he wasn't a God. Amen?
Amen.
And so, then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. But did I skip the verse? Okay, let me go back to verse 4. Then the presidents and the princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find none occasion nor fault, for as much as was faithful, neither was there any error and fault in him, found in him. Then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Aha! What do we got? You got Daniel's faith and his politics. And again, every man and woman of God, their faith and their politics are inseparable, if they're truly men of God. Then these presidents and princes assembled them together to the king and said thus to him, O King Darius, live forever, and all the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the princes and the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and to make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days save of thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing that it not be changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore the king Darius signed the writing and the decree. Now, I don't know about Darius, but if that had been me, I would have been very suspicious of why they would ask me to do such a thing, you see. Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before God as he did aforetime. You see, Daniel was not ashamed of God.
That's right.
All right? And he let them know out there very clearly that he was not ashamed of God. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree. Hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, This thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which altereth not. Then answered they and said before the king, That Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree, and thou hast signed, but maketh his petition 3 times a day. And when the king heard these words, he was sore displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king, and the king and said unto the king, Know, O king, the law of the Medes and the Persians is that no decree nor statute which the king established may be changed. Well, do you understand? You say, well, why didn't the king just change that rule? I mean, Barack Obama, he does things like that through legislative decrees all the time. Well, you see, in those days, if that happened, if the king's word was broken, the king ceased to be king. The king ceased to be king. And that was the law of the Medes and the Persians. And so, then the king commanded that they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake unto the Daniel, Thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet, and with the signet of the lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace, and passed the night fasting, and neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning, and went in haste into the den of lions. When he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver thee from the lions? Then said Daniel to the king, O king, live forever. My God has sent his angel and has shut the mouths of lions, and they have not hurt me, for as much as before him innocent he was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Then said the king, exceedingly glad for him, and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no matter of him was hurt or was found upon him, because he believed in his God. And the king commanded that they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions, them and their children and their wives and the lions and the master of them, and break all their bones in pieces wherever they came at the bottom of the den. A lot of us might say, well, gee, boy, I'm going to tell you, that doesn't seem that God would allow that. Those were innocent people. What about the children? God makes provisions, believe me. Those children, if they are small children, they want right to be with the Lord. God is the most merciful. And you can bet he was with them, even in the lion's den. Even as they were eaten, God had made provision for those children. But what does he tell you? In Proverbs 15, or 105 rather, he says, not to touch my anointed. Not to touch my anointed. Now this next passage, and this makes it pretty clear about your faith and your politics. Then King Darius wrote unto all the people and nations and languages that dwell within the earth, peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God and the steadfast forever, and his kingdom, that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth, he worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth, who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel proposed in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Well, that's a pretty clear picture on how we deal with our faith and our politics. They have to be one of the same. And then, it seems like it's every day now that people are asking me, if Hillary gets elected, what are we going to do? If Hillary gets elected, what are we going to do? Well, first of all, since this is an election sermon, folks, between now and Tuesday, we need to do all that we can do. I mean everything we can do to make sure she doesn't get elected.
That's right.
Okay, we got to talk to whoever we can talk to. We know people that may not vote. Keep an eye out for voter fraud. And boy, they're really going after the nursing homes. The communists are sneaking in there left and right. Okay, but we need to really speak out to people. All of you need to take some of those, more than one, those voter guides, take them and find out if people need them. Because it never fails, always at the last minute, on Tuesday, I'll get all kinds of phone calls, people calling here asking who they should vote for. And they live all over the place, you know. So I don't know, you know, who's on the ballot in their area and that. So this is why it's important. You take these voter guides, get them out to as many people as possible. And I got to tell you this. It doesn't matter whether it's Hillary or Trump. Things are going to go south for us anyhow.
Yeah.
God has told you. I mean, it's going to happen. We see it happening all around the world right now. But we got to remember, always remember who you are.
Amen.
Remember, see, because the world is going to tell you, you people are despicable, okay? You belong in a basket of deplorables. All the world's problems is because of you people. You Christians, you're the ones. What did Obama's former prosecutor have to say? He said that you cannot discriminate against Christians. You cannot discriminate against. He didn't mean that you shouldn't discriminate against Christians. He meant that we're open, we're fair game. That it's open season, just like a baby in the womb is open season to kill it. That Christians should be open season. And so, let's take a look at who we are. Let's go to Romans chapter 6, chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Now, it was Eric Holder that once said that you cannot discriminate against Christians. And again, he was saying that again, we're fair game for any kind of discrimination. And in Romans chapter 6, starting with verse 37, we read this. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Listen, who are you? You're more than a conqueror. Who are you?
More than a conqueror.
Amen. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. You understand? Nor height, nor death, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, I want to remind you what it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 13. It says that the words in this book are not words of men, that these are the words of God himself. This is what it's, the Bible itself says, these are words of God himself. Now, he's telling you that we're more than conquerors through him, and he gives you a whole list here. He tells you that there was nothing in the past, the present, or the future that can separate us from the Lord of God, from the love of God, meaning take away our salvation. There is nothing in the entire universe, nor height nor depth, that can take away. There's nothing in the realm of life or in the realm of death that can take away our salvation. Right?
Amen.
And so if that's the case, how in the world can we lose it? Well, we can't. And that is heresy when people preach that. But anyhow, and then you have to understand, if you go to Philippians 4:13, no. You have to understand something here, verses 10 through 13. Who we are is not based on what we own, folks. The smallest treasures in heaven is worth far, far, far more than the greatest treasures here on earth. You see, the smallest treasures in heaven last forever. The ones here on earth, they're very temporal, very, very temporal. But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now that the last you care of me hath flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, wherewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, bound and to suffer need. I'll tell you where you really learn that, when you get assigned a place over in the jungle someplace, and you're left out there, and you say, we'll see you in 90 days. And you go in there with just the clothes on your back, and that's it. If you're going to have anything to eat, you're going to have to find it and get it for yourself. You learn how to be how bound, okay? And you learn how to be content without, okay? I learned a whole lot of things as a young guy doing that. And again, it's not about... First of all, let me just tell you this, okay? Nobody in here owns anything. Nobody in here owns anything. You have use of things that you have. But if you owned it, you could take it with you when you leave, and you're not going to do it. You're not going to take anything with you when you leave. Right? It reminded me just now, I was talking to Ken Parker's daughter here just recently, and I have a whole box of things I'm sending her, his belongings, his personal. And Ken had this great big tooth, must have been one of the big teeth in the back there, with a big gold filling on it. I mean, it's a huge gold filling, and we had it stuck in some kind of a little bottle, and it was like a pill bottle. I forgot to tell her what's in there because she might be surprised when she opens that bottle and that big tooth rolls out. I should have told her, I guess. But anyhow, he couldn't take that gold with him, could he?
Nope.
So we have to understand that. He says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I've learned whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I know how to be abased. I know how to abound everywhere and in all things. I'm instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. There you go. I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. If you believe, amen, you can do it. And so, we got to remember who we are. And just, I want to turn it over to 1 John. And in 1 John chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. And here we're going to take a look at the spirit of error and the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Now, But the spirit of error today is what we call liberalism. It's the Antichrist system, or another name is political correctness or feeble-mindedness, which is one of the same. But we start in verse 4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Amen. Folks, greater is he that is in us. Well, yeah, you see, you have to understand that. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. We will eventually, we're going to win. I mean, we're going to win the war. Now, we're going to take some weapons and some battles, but we're going to win the war.
That's right.
They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we are the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. And I was arguing with a guy one time. He was telling me there's no error in the Bible. I said, yeah, there is too. Show me one. I showed him right there. It says error right there, right? I mean, it's there, right? Okay. Anyhow, third, remember the mission. Remember our mission. The mission we have, starting with, first of all, with the Great Commission. Simple, I'll just take you there. You all know this, Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Well, I'll go with all power, all right? Amen. I'd rather serve the one that's got all the power.
That's right.
Okay?
That's right.
Than the one who wants to destroy us.
Exactly.
Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Folks, listen to me. He's not talking. Sometimes people think that this refers to just ordained pastors. It refers to everybody in this room right here, right now. Everybody in this room. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. If you're a born-again, Bible-believing Christian, you have the ability to baptize people. You can baptize them. Other people say, well, Pastor, could you come out and baptize? Well, aren't you saved? You can do it. Now, I baptized, I don't even know how many people. I mean, it's been a whole lot of them, I can tell you that, over the years. And then, if you go over to Hebrews chapter 11, and in Hebrews chapter 11, and I'll be there in a minute. Here now. Okay. All right. I'm going to close out and then finish this. We've been coming to you from Doers of the Word Baptist Church, 14781 Sperry Road in Newberry, Ohio. I'm Pastor Sanders, and you've been listening to us this morning on the LibertyWorksRadioNetwork.com. That's the RadioWorksLibertyNetwork.com. You can hear this program replayed at Sundays at 2 a.m., 8 a.m., 2 p.m., and 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Until next week, we want to say good morning, God bless, and remember always, always, keep fighting the fight. Okay. Hebrews 11:32. Remember the mission. The first mission, one, is what we just, the Great Commission. Number two, here, Hebrews 11. And what is this? This means we resist tyranny unto death. We resist tyranny from Genesis to Revelation. And I use this passage because it kind of sums it up. And what shall I more say of the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson, Jephthah, of David also, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant and fight, turned to fight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead, raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they may obtain the better resurrection. And others had a trial of cruel mockings and scourging. Yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder. They were tempted, were slain, and the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, and tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And all of these, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. All of these were the great, courageous Jewish soldiers of the past, like David's mighty men. These were the great, courageous prophets of Israel. God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Well, the mighty Jewish believers never got God's total reward because they died before Christ came. He was showing that Jesus, he was showing the Jews that Christianity offers a much, much better way than Judaism ever did. And then, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 5 through 12, now the Holy Spirit dwells in us. We are of the doer, we are to be doers of the word, not just hearers, lest we grieve the Holy Spirit. Verse 5, remember you not that when I was